Come home to Jesus. This is the message that Max Solbrekken has proclaimed for 50 years to multitudes across the world. His crusades have taken him to the Hindus of India, Muslims of Pakistan, Buddhists of Sri Lanka, voodoo worshippers of Haiti, Catholics of Malta, and headhunters of Northern Luzon. He has preached God's word in stadiums, churches, tents, universities, and prisons. He comes to you today with the message of God's love and power. The man who is not afraid to preach the truth, Pastor Max Solbrekken.
Ephesians, reading from chapter 2, beginning at verse number 1, as follows in Jesus' name. And you have he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved, and hath raised us up together, and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were nigh. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints, and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. Shall we bow, please, for prayer? Almighty, eternal God, we bow in thy divine presence. We thank thee for thy presence and thy power. We thank thee for thy goodness and thy mercy. We thank thee for thy ability to help us and thy great love. We thank thee, Lord, that thou art here in our midst. We praise thee, for thou art God. We know that all things are possible to him that believes. We believe, Lord. And so we pray now the blessing of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Ghost upon each person, every man and woman, every boy and every girl, the young people. We pray for the Sunday school as it's in progress now. We pray thy blessing upon all the teachers and all the young people, Lord, in Sunday school. We pray, God, that you will touch every life and every heart. We pray that you will forgive every sinner and heal the sick and fill with the Holy Spirit and bless and prosper the people. We pray for the sorrowing and the needy. We pray for the poor. We ask God that you will bless and strengthen every heart and every life. We pray this for Christ's sake and for God's glory and in Jesus' name. And you may be seated, please. Ephesians, the wealth the walk and the warfare of the Christian. This is my fourth message on the subject of Ephesians, this grand and glorious epistle of St. Paul the Apostle to the Ephesian church. I want to just reiterate briefly and share a little of what we've been covering for those of you who have not heard the past three lectures. Paul, the Apostle of Jesus Christ. The word Paul means little one. Saul of Tarsus was arrogant and proud. Saul of Tarsus was a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. His father had been Pharisees before him. He was a man who was a very, very great rabbi, a teacher, trained at the feet of Gamaliel, one of the greatest, most notable, on his way to Damascus to kill some more Christians, to bind them, to bring them back in chains, to be tried by the religious hierarchy of the Judaic religion. This man, Saul, literally full of hatred, venom, absolutely a terror to the church of the living God, on his way to a foreign city, in his pocket, letters from the high priest, but suddenly arrested by Christ, suddenly stopped. A great light from heaven shone upon him, and Saul the Great fell upon the earth. And he heard a voice saying, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And he cried out, "Lord, who art thou?" "Who are you, Lord?" The voice said, "I am Jesus. I am Yeshua. I am the Savior. I am the Messiah, the Messiah, the Jewish Messiah. I am the Christ, the Anointed One, whom you are persecuting." He'd never seen Jesus. Never laid his eyes upon the Christ up until that point in time. But now he saw him, and when he saw him, he became blind. He had been persecuting the followers of Christ, Jews who had accepted Jesus. And his life was transformed and changed. And ladies and gentlemen, I could speak for a week of Sundays on the conversion of Paul. I can turn agnostics to Christ and atheists to Jesus by preaching of the great conversion of St. Paul. Saul of Tarsus, who became the great apostle. Napoleon Bonaparte is dead and gone. Alexander the Great. We read about him and study about him. He doesn't even compare with Paul the Apostle, who changed the course of the world by the preaching of the gospel of Christ. And today across the world, we have literally millions of Christians 2,000 years after the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus. 2,000 years almost since Paul moved across the planet. And today, Christianity is vibrant and powerful. So much so that the president of the USA stood up on national television and preached a message that was as powerful, possibly, as any gospel preacher, as he talked about the power of God and that we must turn back to Jesus in this wicked and desperate generation. But here's the man who was Saul the Great, who became Paul the Little One. Paul the Small One. Talk about humility. All through Ephesians, six chapters, the most powerful book, I believe, in the Bible. Six chapters, so weighty and so powerful that if the Christian church would read it and believe it and live it, we would transform the world as Paul did, the people of his generation. All through this book, by Christ, in him, in whom, according to his will, predestinated, God's purpose, the beloved, in whom we trusted, until of him, his glory, his power, in the heavenly places, in Christ, all power, all riches, far above. The theme, far above, in heavenly places, in Christ, in whom. Nothing about Paul, nothing about Saul of Tarsus, but the little one is talking about the one he saw, the great one he met, on the road to Damascus, the great one who changed his life. Two prayers as Saul prays. The first prayer in Ephesians chapter 1 that we covered on Friday night, and I wish to read it again for those of you that were not at the service. He says in verse number 15, "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you and making mention of you in my prayers." Here's the prayer. The first prayer, Ephesians 1, "that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him." How many of you really know Him? Two things we need to do. We need to get to know Him. Then we need to know who we are in Him. We need to get to know Him and understand who He is. And then once we have gotten to know Him, then we need to realize who we are in Him. What we can do through Him. What is our purpose for being here. And that's to bring praise and glory unto His precious name. "That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling," number one. What a calling. And number two, "what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints." He's got something invested in you. He's invested a lot in you. We talk about our inheritance in Him. What about His inheritance in us? Let me tell you, when Christ died for the sins of the world, He gave everything He had. Oh, He has something invested in you, my friend. You say, "Well, I really have an investment in the kingdom of God." Yes, you do. You have an investment. When you gave your heart to God, you gave yourself to God. You gave your life to God. You gave your time and your ability and your money to God. You live for God. The church and the kingdom of God and the things of Christ is your life. But you've given Him nothing in comparison to what He's given you. First of all, He invested His Son, the blood of His Son. And Jesus died that we might live. He who was rich became poor, so we could become rich through Him. He who knew no sin became sin, so we could become righteous through Him. And He who was never sick in His life became so sick that He died on Calvary's cross that you might be healed. And He who was life died so you might live. And after He had died upon the cross, He arose from the dead and poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. What an investment. "The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye might know what is the hope of His calling, what is the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints," His inheritance, "and what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward," His power to you. We know what His power is in the world. He made the worlds. He sent Christ. He raised Him from the dead. We know that. But what many people don't know is His power in your life. What is His power to usward? To you and me. That's what we need to know. "What is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe, according to the work of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead." Oh, what a miracle. The same power that God used to raise Christ from the dead is available to you and me. That's what the Bible says. "And He set Him on His own right hand in the heavenly places." And we're in Christ, so we're also seated there. Don't forget it. Far above all gossip, far above all lies, far above lust and greed and pride and hatred, far above sin and sickness and fear, far above the demons of hell. We are seated in heavenly places in Christ, far above. The Bible says in the Garden of Eden, the Scripture tells us that God spoke and God said to the serpent, He said, "I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between the devil that was in the serpent. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed," that's the hosts of the devil, "and her seed," that's Christ. Enmity. Enmity, a battle between God and the devil, between the devil and his forces, and Christ and His church. Enmity. And the Bible says that Christ and His church would defeat the devil. As a matter of fact, the seed of the woman would bruise the serpent's head. And we are the body of Christ, And we are seated with him in heavenly places, and we are far above all principalities and all power and every demon and every man and woman and anyone who might oppose the purpose of God, because Christ is above anyone upon this earth and all upon this earth and under the earth. He is above all. And we are in Christ, growing up into Christ, far above all these things and all these powers. He is the head, and we are the body. Now, Paul, the apostle, the little one, has lifted us up to the heavenlies and shown us who we are in Christ in chapter 1. Now, in chapter 2, he plunges us back into reality to show us how dirty and filthy we were before we accepted Christ. He wants us to know the pit out of which we have come. He wants us to remember. So he says, and you hath he quickened. He's made alive. You hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. If you're a sinner, if you have not accepted Christ, you are dead in your trespasses and sins. And those of us who are saved, we have been quickened. We were dead one time, but we are alive. Hallelujah. Once I was blind, but now I see. Once I was lost, but now I'm found. You hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past, way back there, ye walked according to. Notice the word according to. According to. The according to, we have God's power. According to his love, his grace, his mercy. According to his power, his laws, his grace. But then there is another according to. And that's according to the course of this world. Are you walking according to the course of this world? According to the prince of the power of the air. That's the devil. Sinners obey the devil. The spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. That devil, that spirit, that unclean demon that works in the hearts and the lives of unregenerate, disobedient people who blaspheme and lie and fornicate and curse and swear and blaspheme, and those who are full of unbelief. It's the spirit of the devil that works within them, and they're walking down his road, and they are in his kingdom. And all of us were there at one time. None of us have been born without this devilish nature called the Adamic nature. All born in sin, all shaped in iniquity. All of us sinners by birth and by choice. But some of us have seen the light. And some of us, and hopefully most of us, and prayerfully all of us, have been changed. And we are now children of the living God, among whom also we all had our conversation. Every one of us, in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, I like that. But God came on the scene. But God prepared a salvation. But God sent his Son. But God came to our rescue. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in our sins, hath quickened us, made us alive together in Christ. By grace are you saved. And hath raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We are even at this moment and in this hour, we are seated in heavenly places with Christ far above. Don't ever forget it. When troubles come your way, when the devil lies to you, when things go wrong, you are seated in heavenly places in Christ. You are not of this world. Your feet are on the solid rock. You're not mucking around in the mire and the filth and the dirt of this world, but you are a God's person. You're a son of God, a daughter of God. You're an heir of God, a joint heir with Christ. You are a living stone in the building of God, a lively stone. You're a part of God's building. You're a part of God's house. You're a part of God's kingdom. You're a member in particular. You don't belong with the filth and the muck and the mire. You don't belong. Well, I want you to know that man is special. The Bible says God created man in His own image. God made man in His own likeness, and we are special. And man fell. And when man fell, of course, that took away the specialty. For man has now fallen lower than the angels. God's Word tells us that even the devil believes and trembles. And God's children are special. You've been chosen. The Bible says God chose you. Before the foundations of the world, God chose you. God knew this meeting would take place. God knew you'd be here this Sunday morning, that you'd accept Christ. God knew that. I'm ecstatic with God's love and power and grace this morning. I know my place in Christ, and the devil can't touch me. That's why Jesus said, "Behold, I give unto you power over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." That's why He said, "Go and preach the gospel, and heal the sick, cast out devils, and even raise the dead." Why? I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. I was there, and I saw him fall. I saw Michael pick him up and throw him out. Oh, praise the Lord. For by grace are ye saved. We're saved this morning. Woo! I'm saved. For by grace are ye saved through faith. And that not of yourselves is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Jesus is our peace, who hath made both one. That's the Gentile and the Jew brought together. That's the mystery of the gospel. That the black and the white can worship together, drink from the same cup. That the brown and the yellow can gather together, worship together. That the Irish and the English can worship together. And the French and the English and the Jew and the Arab. One in Christ. That's the mystery of the gospel. That He can bring us together. For He is our peace, who hath made both one. Notice in chapter 1, He gives the greeting of the Greeks as well as the greeting of the Jews. Writing to Jews and Greeks, Gentiles and Jews who have both been converted. And He says, grace, keres. That's the greeting of the Greeks. Keres and shalom. Grace and peace, the greeting of the Jews. So this is the great mystery, that He is our peace, who hath made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. The partition between the Gentile and the Jew, between the English and the French and the black and the white. The partition is broken down. In Christ we all come together in one. There is no racial prejudice. There is no national prejudice. We're all together in one. A Christ-like one. A new man. We were sinners. We were in the flesh. We were old men. We were flesh people. Now we're Jesus people. Our allegiance now is in Christ. One new man. This is the work of God now, to create a brand new man who is not of this world. Who lives in the world but is not of the world. Who walks through it and walks right through the filth and doesn't get dirty. Who walks among the sick and doesn't get sick. When he gets sick, he gets healed. Who speaks in tongues and casts out devils and rejoices in the Spirit. A new man. Isaiah chapter 28. For with stammering lips and other tongues will God speak to this people. But yet for all this they will not hear. They'll fall backwards. They'll be snared. And they will be taken. They won't believe. Well, I'm going to wind up this message and continue again tonight. Shall we bow, please, for prayer?
For 50 years, Pastor Max Solbrekken has awakened the conscience of his audiences through the anointed proclamation of the claims of Christ, who said, "No man can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and mammon. The truth is, you are either for him or against him. You cannot remain neutral." Great costs are involved in spreading of Christ's gospel. Please consider investing in this ministry. Contact Max Solbrekken at MSWM, Box 44220, RPO, Garside, Edmonton, Alberta, T5V1N6, Canada. have been watching the Come Home to Jesus television ministry with Canada's preacher man, Dr. Max Solbrekken, who has proclaimed the Word of God across the world for 50 years without fear or favor of man or devil. Ask for Canada's revival magazine, The Cry of His Coming, when you write. Invest in souls by supporting this end-time ministry. Please contact Max Solbrekken at MSWM, Box 44220, RPO Garside, Edmonton, Alberta, T5V1N6, Canada. Oh, die again and cry.